Hi, I'm Vanessa, and I love bad Star Trek. I break down the bad episodes of my favorite show so you don't have to watch it. I will be the dry-ass rainforest that is Star Trek Voyager. Today, I will be talking to you about an episode called Tattoo. The episode Tattoo came out in 1995, 27 years after that very racist and terrible episode, The Paradise Syndrome, in the original series. By this point, Star Trek has 30 years of franchise behind them, with several spin-off series, novelizations, and 6 movies out by that point, the latest being The Undiscovered Country, which was awesome. So now, with a Native American character on the show, and having to give him a backstory, which by season 2 was desperately needed, do the writers improve representation of Natives at all? Disclaimer, I'm a white person, but the only improvement appears to be that they have abstained from casting white people this time. To its credit, Tattoo is far more watchable and has a very funny B-plot involving the Doctor, of course, and getting data on a character that we barely know but always see is pretty valuable. However, even by the writer's own admission, it still produces more questions than answers. But not in an intriguing and mysterious way. Some things just don't make sense about Chakotay's upbringing. While the cast may not be white, they're not from a similar background and may not even necessarily all be Native. Robert Beltran is Latino, which is a mix of indigenous and Spanish, and the leader of the tribe that they find in flashback is a half Cherokee, and so the writers are still clearly treating Natives as a single entity with interchangeable cultures and beliefs, and our old pal Giorgio Tsoukalos with that creature on his head is back with a vengeance with more racist conspiracy theories and forming this story, because that's what white people tend to fall back on when they step over Natives and don't include them in the writing process because they don't know what the fuck they're talking about. In activist spaces, there is a saying that goes, nothing about us without us. And Tattoo is yet another case study as to why that is. First, what's the fun B-plot? Unfortunately, it does have a misogynist beginning when the Doctor examines a pregnant Naomi Wildman, whose pinched sciatic nerve is causing her a lot of pain. The Doctor is just like, what's the big deal? Which gives me a bunch of flashbacks as a uterus owner being told by many doctors that my pain doesn't fucking mean anything.
Perhaps a day of rest off duty.
Ensign Wildman, according to your medical history, this is your first pregnancy, correct?
Yes.
Well, Ensign, unfortunately, pregnancy causes its fair share of discomforts, and you'll have to learn to live with them.
And Kes, his assistant, chides him for having no bedside manner, and the Doctor responds that even if he was sick, he wouldn't be complaining as much as the crew. And because he's prideful and ridiculous, he programs himself a virus, a 29-hour flu that gives him the sniffles and the coughs, but obviously he's not contagious because he's a hologram. And the Doc seems to be winning the bet that doesn't exist by not really complaining until the very end, when the flu was lasting 1 hour longer than he programmed it for, and has a total and complete meltdown and calls Janeway demanding help.
Doctor, I'm sorry, but we have more pressing matters to-
You can't leave me like this. I need help. Now, get me somebody who can tweak the computer and make me feel better immediately.
And it turned out that Kes had actually programmed a few extra hours just to teach him a lesson. And so that was kind of funny. Taught him a little bit of humility, but not really. As for the rest of it, while searching an uninhabited moon for a material called polypharenide for the ship, Tuvok draws Chakotay's attention to a symbol that he finds on the ground.
There have been other visitors to this moon recently.
What do you think this is? Some kind of message?
Which instantly gives Chakotay a flashback to his childhood, to being a teenager being dragged along an expedition in the Central American jungle with his father. And young Chakotay spots the exact same symbol carved into a log as his dad explains to him that it's a chamuzi, or a blessing to the tree that the rubber people that they're tracking down have cut down.
It's a blessing to the land, an ancient healing symbol. A chamusi. They probably cut this down for firewood.
The rubber tree people.
Well, the closest thing to the ancient rubber tree people that we'll ever see.
And he does some more explaining that they are both descended from said rubber tree people. And some still live in the jungle on some sacred land. Even in this little blip of a flashback, there is so much to unpack. Chakotay's dad is played by a Puerto Rican, and the rest of the folks in this traveling group, his young Chakotay included, are just not white, as far as I can tell. Their IMDBs are pretty scant, and the language that they're speaking in this scene appears to be just dramatically delivered babble, which is just a completely unnecessary form of erasure.
No, who's in it? Chakotay. Can you post?
The rubber tree people is also a name made up by the white writers of the show, and at best, this might be a mistranslation of Olmec, or the inhabitants of the rubber tree forest in Central America, not rubber tree people or rubber people, as Chakotay sometimes uses interchangeably. And at worst, this is a case of the colonizer labeling the colonized by what they deem as their most valuable commodity. Between the late 1800s and early 1900s, the British-owned Peruvian Amazonian company committed what is now called the Putumayo Atrocities, as they destroyed villages and raped and enslaved the Witotos, Akaina, Bora, Nanuya, and Ndokes, wiping out 90% of the native population in the area and killing about 100,000 people. These people were worked to death harvesting rubber, and when they didn't meet their quota, the company would literally set them on fire for fun. So to call them rubber people is likely the equivalent of calling African Americans the cotton people, which is extremely disrespectful, offensive, and dehumanizing. Either way, not a good look. The chamusi is yet another white concoction and was introduced in season one because Chakotay carries one in his medicine bundle shown in the cloud back in season one when he was giving out spirit animals, like Oprah gave out cars that one time. So the flashback has to be more for the audience than Chakotay. But yeah, it would be weird to find that symbol in the Delta Quadrant just traced into some random moon by an old campfire, 70,000 light years from Earth. Janeway also finds this mystery intriguing, and Chakotay gives a supernatural explanation that he possibly may have found the home of the sky spirits who created the first rubber people and imparted knowledge on them, so like the ancestors of his ancestors, and somehow compared this with Adam and Eve, and that somehow jiving with evolution. Like, there's a lot of leap here as a believable origin story.
How much faith do you put in Adam and Eve? Hasn't science proved that all humans developed from a single evolutionary process?
Man, the Bible contradicts itself so many times. Its continuity is honestly shit. Like, even after the pages and pages of begatting trying to explain the entire population of the world, out of nowhere, people will just come upon cities packed with people. Even the clown-cariest of uteruses can't possibly populate an entire city before you even get there. That's not even close to right. But it's also extremely offensive to say that somehow a native's evolutionary trajectory is drastically different from everyone else's. So now we're back at natives aren't human territory. The writers really keep writing themselves in racist-ass circles. Since the crew has to stay there to continue looking for the polypharenide and now possibly have to interface with an alien population to get access, Janeway gives permission to Chakotay to continue exploring why the chamusi was on the surface, which gives him the opportunity to dig into his origins and make amends with his father's memory. Chakotay brings security officer Tuvok, chief engineer Belana Torres, and Neelix with him to the surface, and Neelix is the ship's cook. I'm not sure why he's going with them other than to be comic relief, and because there is electromagnetic turbulence that's keeping people from beaming to the surface, they go ahead and take a shuttle. And on the way down, Chakotay has another flashback where his father explains what a rainforest is.
That's why they call it a rainforest.
Like a forest with rain in it. And says that maybe the people pick this land because it's just so full of life, even with bugs.
Sorry, sky spirits. I will never make friends with bugs.
Like, they really force this shitty teenager thing. And his dad's like, yeah, I know you're really miserable and I'm sorry that I made you come. I knew you were a rebel when you were born upside down. Everybody's born upside down. Everyone. Unless you're a breech birth. And he's like, I'm not a rebel. I do my own thing.
No one chooses for me. I choose my own way.
He's literally a rebel without a cause. Which, if you write a character to be flatly contrary, that's what happens. You contradict someone saying that you're contrary, which is a double negative. Being contrary might explain why he joined Starfleet against his father's wishes and later the Maquis, but it certainly doesn't explain why he would align himself with Janeway the day after she was on her way to drag him to jail. Why did he just go, yes, ma'am? He could have mutinied the shit out of Voyager and chose not to. We don't really get a character arc that explains that. So this character's inconsistencies become more obvious when focused on for an entire episode. And we get a bit of a callback to Shatner seeing a thing on the wing when Chakotay sees a face in the lightning outside of a window. On the surface, Chakotay is reminded of his jungle trip since the flora appears exactly the same, which is weird. And I always enjoy seeing Neelix get on Tuvok's last nerve.
Then we have something in common. I breed orchids too. Don't they make the most exquisite salad? A touch of baldoxic vinegar, pure heaven.
And he hears an eagle, which shouldn't be out there. It reminds him of the conversation with his father when he said he was leaving his tribe for Starfleet.
I'm leaving the tribe, Father.
What?
I got to know a lot of the Starfleet officers patrolling the Cardassian border. I asked Captain Sulu if he would sponsor me at Starfleet Academy.
Can't he be a rubber tree person and in Starfleet? That doesn't make any sense. So this conflict feels really super forced and nonsensical since his father chides him for joining the modern world when they live in a Cardassian border town, which is in the modern world.
Well, you've never fully embraced the traditions of our tribe, I know that. And you've always been curious about other societies, and that is why I allowed you to read about them.
So they haven't assimilated entirely. I just found his background to be really confusing. So Chakotay is disconnected from his ancestral home, but they still carry on the traditions, even though there's so much of it that Chakotay is hearing about for the first time in this flashback sequence. Like, he didn't even know what a chamuzi was. He didn't even know what a rainforest was. He doesn't speak any of the rubber language. So what are they fighting about? I'm confused. Before we get more data, Chakotay snaps out of the flashback just in time for Neelix's eyeballs to almost get clawed out by an eagle. No one can beam down, but they can beam up. So Neelix gets beamed out to sickbay, and Tuvok discovers a glass and metal sort of tent-like structure. And again, more contrived conflict here when Tuvok recites Starfleet protocol to him after Chakotay asks him to put down his weapon.
Lay down your weapons.
Commander.
Disarm. I want them to see that we don't pose any threat to them.
May I remind the commander that Starfleet protocol demands that away teams remain armed and ready to defend themselves until contact is made.
I know all about Starfleet protocol, Lieutenant.
Dropping weapons because your commander has asked you to is not that big of a deal. And we're again here in flashback when Chakotay meets the Central American jungle tribe, and they all have wrinkles on their head, which visually suggests that they're not quite human. And the leader is the half Cherokee guy. So I don't know who in this entire group is actually from Central America. Anyway, back in the present time, a storm hits and a tree falls on Chakotay, knocking him out, and Tuvok and B'Elanna leave him behind. Pine and beam back to Voyager, which they do pretty quickly. Like, and as Chakotay comes to, he's uninjured and he walks around finding himself alone, and he starts to strip naturally, which flashes him back to the rubber people trying to tear his clothes off, which was really fucking weird and ridiculous. And you see his father getting a tattoo similar to the one Chakotay has later, so now we know the origin of that. When we return from the little homecoming flashback, Chakotay's ass is showing, but it's not his real ass. Robert Duncan McNeil discussed on the podcast Delta Flyers, which I highly recommend for anybody who is a Voyager fan, but UPN was against showing butt crack. And so for this scene, they had Beltran wearing flesh-colored underwear. After they filmed it and the network saw it, they're like, ew, that's weird. He's got like a long back. Fix it, you know? So they had the visual effects people go in and draw a digital butt crack. And he weirdly and conveniently finds a tunic outfit, and he walks through a wall of lightning to meet his alien relatives. And the leader of which is played by Richard Fancy, a white guy who is speaking the rubber language, which Chakotay doesn't understand, but he says he speaks some Spanish, but mostly just English. And Robert Beltran said that this was what resonated with him the most personally.
I'm sorry. I don't know the ancient language of my people. I can't understand.
So I think the writers could have done themselves a huge favor and asked him about that experience, being caught between two worlds, to inform the writing of this character. Instead of that, we have a white alien telling Chakotay that he met his ancestors as they were traversing the Bering Strait, a theory, by the way, which no longer holds true.
45,000 years ago, on our first visit to your world, we met a small group of nomadic hunters. They had no spoken language, no culture except the use of fire and stone weapons. But they did have a respect for the land and for other living creatures that impressed us deeply. We decided to give them an inheritance, a genetic bonding, so they might thrive and protect your world.
And the aliens admired them, even if they had no language and culture, and imparted them with the knowledge that helped them survive. Like, okay, I get it. You have to have Chakotay talk about his past, and so you are challenged with connecting the Delta Quadrant with his identity. But do they have to do it literally with another racist conspiracy theory? Like, this time it's that alien astronaut thing. Like, some groups have this weird big-headed looking dudes drawn on cave paintings, and white people looked at it and were like, oh my god, they saw aliens. But then taking it a step further into another racist conspiracy theory, going all the way back to Andrew Jackson and saying that it's alien DNA that made them survive and have culture and language. Like, that's unspeakably racist. That's so racist. And all the while, Voyager has lost contact with Chakotay, and they're trying to land the ship, which is something Voyager can do, to locate and grab Chakotay because all their sensors are out of whack. But the planet itself is wreaking havoc with the ship, and at one point Harry Kim's like, it's a twist!
Captain, it's a cyclone.
But once Chakotay's like, hey, I'm one of you, the aliens turn off the wind machine, Chakotay makes peace with his father's memory, and it's over. Look at how much shit they had to pull out of thin air to give Chakotay backstory, when they literally could have just talked to Beltran, asked him to collaborate with a Native American sci-fi writer, like, and weave in his background, make the tapestry of Trek richer with the truth, rather than white people making up a babble language and bullshit symbols out of nowhere. With Prodigy, the new series, they're supposed to apparently include Chakotay. I have some grave concern about how they're going to deal with this stereotype of a character. I just hope they fucking fix it. Fix it! They've had plenty of time to do so. If you're white like me, please find out whose native land you live on and donate to their mutual aids. Like, subscribe, no pressure, but peer pressure. Till next time, I guess.